Please take a seat. Very, very welcome to you. I'm very, very honored. Mr. Panh, apart from a retrospect of his work with, among others, the missing picture that you can see after this this masterclass, we show also other films of him, like the S21. But also he compiled a fantastic, really a fantastic top 10 with filmmakers like Robert Kramer, Imamura, and our own Joris Evens. If you have the chance to see those films, please do. And I'm sure he will tell a lot about these films in his masterclass. So I'd like to introduce you to the moderator of this afternoon, the hoofddirecteur, how do you say, what is your function exactly? The filmkrant. The editorial chief of our most important film newspaper in the Netherlands, Dana Linse. Give her a big hand, please.
And then, of course, we have an interpreter, and that's Robert Meeks, and he will join us because we're going to have this conversation in English here this afternoon. But if Rithy Panh prefers to speak French, which is, of course, his second tongue, we will have a little bit of interpretation going on. But I'm sure that you will have the patience for that, and after all, it's all about communication here today. So once again, it's really exciting to see such a huge crowd here today, and I'm very honored to be speaking to Rithy Panh about his work. I think we compiled a beautiful program here with some clips of his work and some clips from the top 10 films. We're going to talk about time and memory, so some of the clips will take some time to unfold. Instead of choosing like 50 10-second clips, we decided to go with the flow and have some 5 or 6 minute clips, but I think that really gets to the core of what Mr. Panh's work is about. So Rithy, in your last film, L'image manquante, The Missing Picture, which is now also being submitted for the Oscar for Best Documentary and Best Foreign Film, you describe that as a child you visited the film studios in Phnom Penh in Cambodia in the late 60s and the early 70s because a neighbor was working there as a film director. So do you recall your first movie going memories? There's a little talk of that, but could you tell like your first cinematic memory?
First, thank you for coming for this conversation. Of course, I prefer to talk with you about how to cook a Cambodian dish, but I have to talk about cinema, so I will try the best I can. In fact, I went to my neighbor house. It's like my uncle, because in Cambodia, everybody is uncle of everybody. I went to my uncle house to see the film shooting, but I never want to be a film director. At the beginning, I would like to be a teacher like my father, or astronaut,
astronaut,
or something like that, because I see the Apollo 13 on the TV, and we talk about a lot about Apollo 13 a lot, and it's magic for me to see this man walking on the moon. And when I start to make a film, I try not to talk about this souvenir, because if I told people that I, whenever I went to this film studio, every journalist will write, he went to make film because he was in studio, he was a child, when he was a child. So I prefer to forget it, but it's the souvenir stay and remain in me. We make a film, but not like to. It's like an entertainment, you know, like a dream. People do that because there is a Cambodian tale from which book, a legend, and they adapt it, make a film. But I was very passionate by these people that we can call them like artisan.
Craftsman?
Craftsman?
Yeah.
Craftsman. Craftsman,
yeah. And because in the 60s there was quite a lively Cambodian film culture, so did you go to the cinema a lot or?
Yes. One of the first film I have seen is a King film, King Sihanouk movie. And after that, the second one is The Ten Commandments with Jules Briner. And I sometimes when I like watch, I like very much watching film. So sometimes when I was, I escaped from the school and go to watch a film and near the old market, the Sachas, you know, in the town to watch Seven Men Go to Hell or something like that. But I like it very much watching film, but you know, it's not the reason that I make the film.
No, but then of course, 1975, the Khmer Rouge took power and all images disappeared from your country. That is something you describe in The Missing Image.
Yes, you know, but in Cambodia it was not like in India or in Philippines, you know. There in India you have a very cinematography, Indian cinematography in tradition. In Cambodia, just making film like entertainment, you know, and according to my point of view, I don't think that there are no golden age of cinema in Cambodia. It just, we start just shooting and people discover the cinema. At when I was a small child, we went also to watch play, a lot of play, traditional play like opera, you know, they sing, they act. And now you cannot find such theater in Phnom Penh.
So I think the best way and also the toughest way to introduce this change that happened in the 70s is watch a little clip from the beginning of L'Image Manquante, the Missing Image, a film that premiered at the Certain Regards section of the Cannes Film Festival this year and was rewarded there with the top prize. You in that film you revisit your childhood and you take us back to this day and moment in history where all color disappeared and everything became black. We're going to talk about the film after the clip. I just wanted to tell to the audience, it's really tough to find a way to introduce Rithy Panh's work, so we decided just to do it the hard way. So we take a leap of faith or a leap of courage, or as the philosopher Søren Kierkegaard, who invented or used that term, would have said, a leap to faith and a leap to courage. So we take a leap to Phnom Penh in Cambodia, 1975, and we're going to watch that 6 minutes from The Missing Image now.
Puis la guerre est venue. Les bombardements se sont rapprochés dans les années 70. Je me souviens des premiers morts, de notre peur, de ma tristesse d'enfant. Il y a tant d'images qui passent, repassent dans le monde, qu'on croit posséder parce qu'on les a vues. Quand on découvre une image sur un écran, qui n'est pas un tableau, un linceul, alors elle ne manque pas. Phnom Penh a été encerclé par les Khmers rouges qui venaient mettre fin à l'injustice et à l'exploitation. Ils sont entrés dans la capitale le 17 avril 1975. Il n'y a pas eu de cri de joie, mais une attente silencieuse. J'y étais. Je me souviens du regard de ces jeunes combattants, comme si nous n'avions pas été là. On leur avait donné un ordre, ne jamais toucher l'ennemi de la main. L'ennemi, c'est moi. J'ai 13 ans. La banque centrale est dynamitée avec ses billets. Il n'y a pas de retour possible. La ville est impure. La ville est corrompue. Elle est vidée en quelques heures. 2 millions de personnes sont jetées sur les routes et abandonnent leurs maisons, leurs proches, leurs souvenirs. En fait, l'ancien monde. Vive le très glorieux 17 avril, jour de joie débordante. La révolution est si pure qu'elle ne veut pas d'être. Maintenant, Phnom Penh peut être filmé, comme dans la prophétie de Put Tum Nhi. Les maisons seront sans habitants, les rues sans passants, les escaliers, personne ne les montrera. Des rivières de sang couleront. Très vite, nous avons été séparés. Nous avons roulé vers la campagne en pleine saison sèche. Nous avions faim et soif. Nous sommes passés de main en main, comme des bêtes, dans des wagons à bestiaux, puis en charrette. La déportation de Phnom Penh est une image manquante. Tout de suite, les Khmers rouges ont compté, puis séparé les femmes, les hommes, les adultes, les enfants. Interdit tout souvenir, tout effet personnel. Soudain, il n'y a plus d'individus, mais des numéros. On coupe nos cheveux. On confisque montres, lunettes, jouets, livres. On teint nos vêtements en noir. On change nos prénoms. Nous sommes le nouveau peuple. Les bourgeois, les intellectuels, les capitalistes, à rééduquer, à détruire. Tu dois embrasser la condition prolétarienne. Voici le pays nouveau, qu'on appelle Kampuchea démocratique. Une usine aux fumées inquiétantes, des digues et des grisières en béton. Pas d'hommes. Toute la société est organisée de façon collective et militaire, en unité de travail. L'Ankar prend soin de vous tous, camarades, frères et sœurs, pères et mères. L'Ankar, c'est l'organisation. C'est tous, chacun. C'est le jeune Khmer rouge, ou le chef de village, ou le responsable du centre de torture, ou Pol Pot. Il faut surveiller ce peuple de sable, de poussière et de pieds nus. Bientôt, il n'y aura plus de visage, plus d'amis, plus d'amour, plus de père et de mère. Bientôt, il n'y aura plus d'émotions. Et même les mots seront transformés. Chaque être sera un combattant de la révolution ou de l'engrais pour les rizières. Pour tenir, il faut cacher en soi une force, un souvenir, une idée que nul ne peut vous prendre. Car on peut voler une image, pas une pensée.
Okay, I think you call the film The Missing Picture. For a lot of people in Europe, it will also contain unseen pictures or images they're not aware of, or a history that they've neglected. Could you start by telling a bit this concept of the missing picture that you develop in the film? What exactly is that?
The missing picture can be the picture that exists now, but somewhere, I don't know, somebody who hide it, who dig a hole and put it in a hole and somewhere. Or can be also the picture that it's remain in my mind that nobody can, I cannot find it again. Or also can be a situation or even that I would like to live, but I will never live it again. I will, because everybody disappear now. And the most missing feature for me, is my parent now. I imagine that they are old, and I can go for a walk with them. It's not only the picture that under the Khmer Rouge regime or before the Khmer Rouge regime.
So it works on many levels.
Yes, but you know, it's very simple, my cinema, you know, that you can find idea, great idea much more deeper than me. But it's cinema for me like an experience, you know. I have a lot of questions and I try to find if there is some solution somewhere. And so I start with the fact it this picture remain in me, and this genocide has no images. You can see at the train sequence, for example, you can see the train, you can see the railway, you can see the driver, but you cannot see people who were deported. So I try just to put people who were deported in images, because these people miss for me. I miss these people. Very simple. Yeah.
And then you came up with the idea to recreate this world with clay.
No. It's not immediately. When I start to make a film, I have just a title. I think that this title is a very nice title. Missing picture. I went like that, and the producer asked me to write some script, and I write a 30 page of lying, of liar. I lie and during 30 pages because I talk about my cat. But it was good because they told me that Chris Merker has a cat. It's very strange, life is very strange. So I think that they trust me, they have a confidence that in my work. And I start to travel in the country, and first I watch at the Khmer Rouge archive, a lot of Khmer Rouge archive, and I observed that some print, pellicule voilée,
some images, some negatives.
No, it's like when you load the print and the sun hit it before you close the pellicule, the print. On appelle ça l'image voilée. We can say bad exposure images in the print, for example. And normally we throw it. We don't use these images. But the Khmer Rouge keep everything, keep even this bad exposure print. And I just asking myself why they keep it. And step by step, and I worked before on S21. And I remember that in S21 file, we have more than 500,000 pages. I don't read all the pages, but I read a lot. And I remember that I read a confession from a cameraman, cinematographer, who was executed at S21 Center because they have some accident technique, and because also he shot the scene that we can see sick or ill people or very teeny people who work without shoes, etc. And they was he was accused as the CIA agency. And I start to see to find this confession, and I start to meet a lot of photograph and cinematographer Khmer Rouge. And I shot for one year and a half like that.
S21 is the main or one of the 150, I think, prisons, execution centers that were all over the country. You also made a film about that. We're going to talk about it later.
Yeah.
They indeed had a huge archive, so this cameraman was executed there. Yeah. You used some of the material
of this
in the film.
Cameraman, yes. And I find the idea to use the clay figurine only after 1 year and a half of work, because I want to go back to my home. I leave my home in 75, when the Khmer Rouge arrived in Phnom Penh. We were deported, and I have never back there again. I cannot go back there, and for many years. And it's the first time I would like to see how my house looked like now. And when I went to my house, it was completely destroyed. And at the time, I talked to my assistant that we have to create what I imagine. I know exactly where is my room, where is the kitchen, where my parents' room, etc. And they start to create the models, but they are not architects, so they cannot build a model. So because you are not architect, I was very angry because you are not an architect. So I asked them, well, do like we were a child. When we were a little boy, we play with clay, and we sculpt a car, people, you know. And we start, you sculpt, you have to produce for me clay figurine like I was 13. See, the guy start to sculpt, and when I see the sculpture, the figurine, I said, oh, it's I don't want to, comment dire, exaggerate thing, but it's like a mirror or you know, like a great artist work. It's like something very expressive. It's at the same time very, there's something like the innocence of a childhood who come immediately, and I say, okay, we will change completely the film. We will make the new missing picture with the archive, only archive, and clay figurine. And I keep only one sculptor for 100 and 100 figurine. Because if you put three or four or five sculptor, it's not the same work, you know. It's like a factory, but not, you cannot direct the clay figurine like you can direct an actor or actress. So, you know, from real experience, from question that I ask to myself, I create, I try. What I try to do is to not to be only to give testimony. I don't want to do that. I don't want to be. Of course, I know I'm a survivor, but I don't want to be only a survivor who give testimony. I would like to come back with real cinematography proposal each time. And if you watch S21, his style proposal, when you watch Dutch, this is another proposal, and Missing Pictures is another one.
And do you feel like, because when we see this development, you've been kind of chronicling the ghosts of the Cambodian past, and you've been talking to a lot of survivors and victims, but also to perpetrators in S21 and in Dutch and in other films. You feel like you've come to some kind of a closure with this film, and that it's the peeping hole for people to look back on your work?
When I make a film, I don't know exactly what is a plan or of course, after I can see that there is a logic.
Logic?
Yeah, like you know, some work that you build one piece and another one, and you put one piece to another, and you create something who look like a memory. You know, memory change, how many form, and it's not easy to work on memory. But I don't come to this subject because I like to come, because it's a necessity. The reason that I make the film, I become the film director, is the Khmer Rouge. If it was not if Khmer Rouge don't exist, I would be happy to be a teacher or cooker or, you know.
But maybe in a way you're also a teacher in giving these images and these histories back to people in Cambodia, giving them their memory back by creating this time capsule or this memory machine.
Yeah, of course. But that's why it's become a necessity. Because it's very difficult to talk about this subject, because it's in this situation, cinema and intimate life is very near. It's very dangerous. It's very dangerous to go so close to perpetrator, for example, to work with them, to live with them for a month. And because perpetrator is also a human being like you. So at the end, it's, human is bad. Human being is bad. And I think that we are not bad. We live with this evil in us at the beginning, but every day we fight for good to exist. It's why civilization exists. That's why we are here. But it's still be dangerous to have a reflection on this subject, because in my field, cinematography field, for example, we are so close, so we live with that. But in fact, it's what we are. I think that we are died one time, long time ago, in 75, 79, I don't know when exactly, during the Khmer Rouge regime, and we rebirth again. But this time, we rebirth with this death inside of us. And we have just to transmit. We have this, I don't know, it's not a duty, you know, nobody forced me or to do this work. Nobody. I decide to do this work.
But so when we talk about, you were talking about this cinematic closeness and living with the people you're filming, there's definitely some influence from direct cinema and cinema vérité as established by Jean Rouch, and you have a lot of examples in your top 10 of, mm-hmm. of these kind of films, where the filmmakers in America, it was called the fly on the mm-hmm. wall technique or method or strategy, where mm-hmm. the filmmakers really live with their subjects and go along.
Yes, at the beginning, yes, but at the end, we are look like the wind. Everybody will come to the wind. Because we need poetry to survive. We can be close to reality, but there's no reality. There's only my truth, my point of view. And I know what is the fiction, I know what is the reality. I direct a fiction film sometime, and I love very much direct a documentary film. But you direct, even you direct reality, you direct, you choose, you can see that it in Jewish even film, you can see in, you know, in, even in Jean Rouch. And at the end, when you can see at Jewish even, and when Jewish even, he was very engaged, engaged.
Engaged
to cinema in with a great talent and also to some ideology, but at the end he recognized in the wind that only magic is it's like the poetry, you know.
So only, that's yeah. exactly what we're gonna do. We're gonna see some of the clips of the films you. Selected, so we're going to start with this closeness and this reality in D.H. Pennebaker's famous Don't Look Back, which is about Bob Dylan's 1965 UK tour, which is also a way for you to go back to a time you were born then or a little bit before, so you go back by watching that film to a life that didn't happen to you. And then we will watch some of the clips later of Joris Ivens' work he did in China, such as L'Histoire du Vent, The History of the Wind, you were just talking about. But let's start by looking at the beginning of Don't Look Back. We cheated a little bit, for those of you who know the film, and we're very ashamed of it, so you won't be seeing the kind of pre-video clip of Subterranean Homesick Blues, the film starts with, and we also omitted the black during the credits, but we'll give you a nice feeling of that film. So we're going to watch about 6 minutes of the beginning of Don't Look Back. Less than 6 minutes, but you get an idea of the film. I hope it's still on, and otherwise I'm sure someone else will select it for their top 10 next year because it's such a classic. But you saw it again yesterday.
I know very much this film because, you know, we talk about cinema direct and fiction, but you can see that Dylan know very well there is a camera here. How long the film talk, he's very clever, and Pinbecker know very well to, you know, this director, it's a great director like Wong Bing or like Pinbecker or like my favorite Frederick Wiseman, and the body and the camera is unique. And this unique, there is no cameraman and camera, and the film director is unique. And they follow very well. I don't know what happened with it because each film is different. But the talent of this film director is to be to right place, to be here, the right place, and make the film documentary like a fiction film. You know, you have to, comme on dit, fictionnariser le film.
You make fiction.
You take the micro.
Make fiction, introduce fiction into the documentary.
Yes. And you have to put the fiction on the documentary film. And when you watch a film like Faces of
by John Cassavetes,
Cassavetes, John Cassavetes film, and it's the same movement, you know, it's just the same long take, plan séquence, but there's the difficulty is to put the life inside the sequence. And to keep this alive. But every time we give the idea of the fiction, the best documentary film is to use fiction, to put the fiction on the reality. That's my my point of view. And you can do it at the editing. You can also, I like very much documentary film because until the end, you can change sense. Even in editing is very moral in documentary film. I need to edit myself, the film. I need to be there. I cannot let my footage to an editor and I have an editor to sit beside me, but I need to do that. I'm living with footage,
so
you know.
when you shoot a film, do you just like the filmmakers of the cinema vérité in the direct cinema and modern observational filmmakers like Wang Bing, do you shoot a lot of material? I mean, or do you really know what you're looking for when you start to shoot?
Personally, I don't know where I'm going. I try to understand, to find a point but where I'm going, I want to go. Because if you know before, it's not documentary film. You cannot wait for reality. You order to a reality to go to your script.
Yep.
So normally I don't know. And in fact, I don't know where I'm going. And that's why sometimes I'm very happy because you can see things that I did not see before.
shooting is also revealing.
You know, you take film like Skula like that. You know, I like Skula very much because they see a lot of things on my film. Sometimes it's very nice thing to hear. For me, it's and when you make a film, it's like making war or making love. I don't know. Sometimes you're making war, sometimes you're making love. You know, you must to be body to body. If it's the Khmer Rouge, it's making war. It's with the poor people who fight for $1 a day, it's making love. You know, it's something very intimate, something very particular.
Yeah, you described filmmaking as a very physical process, and you just talked about the idea of where to put the camera, and it has to be kind of an organic relationship between the camera and the subject you're filming. You also described it as a sacred image that you create. When the camera is too far away, it's not sacred anymore, and it has to do with looking. Could you explain?
When I try to transmit how to make a film documentary with a young film director, for example, I forbid them to use the long focus, for example, to the zoom, for example. They have to use only one focus and to choke one.
And why is that?
Because they have to move. They have to move. For example, is the one I want to hear somebody there, you cannot with short focus. But you can zoom with long focus and put microphone on them, and you are far from them. And if you have that's why I don't give them this such big microphone. I prefer them to have a boom, and they have to move very near to the people they shoot. If the people in the water, they have to go to the water. Why you don't go to the water? You are afraid because you're close. Why you don't go to the space that there's a lot of sun? It's hot.
So one of the filmmakers who really lives with the people he films is Wang Bing. You already mentioned his name. And you selected a clip from his film Alone, also known as Three Sisters, where I think is perfectly illustrated how it works with the camera at the right place and how, as an audience, you really get to feel the cold just as the filmmaker did. Three Sisters is about three young girls, 10, 6, and 4 years old, who live in a remote village in China. Their mother is walked off, their father is taking a job in the city, and the three girls are mostly left to their own resources. So let's take a little look at that film.
Sure, today. Ring the moon, we're gonna see a burrito.
You can see there is not a lot of change of focus. Only how to move, how to live with people, and with a lot of respect and a lot of dignity. It's great. You know, just move, come back again, be patient, give the time to time, take time to watch and to breathe with people. That's why it's, for me it's better to for film directors. They are great when they make film with people and not about people.
But when you compare this film, which is a modern way of this observational cinema,
it's with not observation. It's not true. I don't like to observation cinema. we are not only observe. We are not here to observe. We are here to be engaged.
So
you have to take side. You have to be with. You are not here just and you know. Observe is very external. You know, it's like anthropologists or ethnologists. You know, we observe us like animals. You know, face, profile. No, it's engagement. You know, to be with, and you can see how he move. Come again, and in 3, 4, 5 minutes, a spectator has to feel that you are here with these children.
We can feel the heat.
You must be images like that. You must to work with a lot of respect.
And one being shoots for very long periods of time.
I never understand. I take on film one time in 7 weeks, and it's a big mistake in my life. And now I take my camera and take time. Sometimes, you know, it's a choice to making a film. If you want, you can also become doctor, or engineer, or businessman. But making a film, especially for documentary film, for a good film, one is take 1 year, 2 years. You know, like produce some sculpture, some, you know, you need time to come back again to watch this angle, and you touch again, you know. We are not slow, we are not fast, we cannot go faster than other artists or other job.
Also, when you say you have to come back and take your time, that is something you also did, for instance, with the film S21, the Khmer Rouge killing machine, where you interviewed people, survivors, victims, but also the perpetrators, and you came back and asked them the same questions again, until you finally got there where they really started to unearth their memories.
Yeah. Each film is different process. When I made the Land of Wandering Soul, you know, you cannot come back again and ask people to say again. It's not possible. You have 8 months for the work, and you take 8 months every day because people work every day, so you have to go every day for 8 months. It's all. And for S21, it's a little bit different because we work on memory, and memory is very complex. And sometimes you cannot tell all, and sometimes people tell too much. And the truth is very particular in memory. So I shoot a sequence today, and I need to find other people to ask them it's happened exactly in this way or not. And after that, I come back again 1 year later and ask the same question for the same sequence. And I like to, when you work on memory, you must to have that there's a lot of level of memory. You have the souvenir, you have the smell memory, and what the cinema can bring is the memory of the body, for example, memory of like a chronology. Yeah, of the gesture, for example, you know, chronology, the exact. It look like a little bit anthropology, it look like a little bit cinematography, but in the body keep everything for a victim also. Did you ask the victim who were beaten? They remember many years later the hurt, something hurt, the wound, you know, in their body.
Maybe we could ask the projectionist if she could skip one of the clips and go directly to the clip we have of S21, while we talk a little bit more about this concept of the memory of the body, because S21 is known as a film where you also use reenactment, even though you don't like the word reenactment. So could you explain a bit more about this situation you created where people actually go back into this memory? And I think we all know what it means, because when you turn like the key in the lock, it's also the memory of the body. But how did you get these people to go back into their bodies and this memory?
I think that they would like also to go back in themselves, these perpetrators, like the victim, you know. Victim, the perpetrator, sometimes there is something very heavy in their heart that they want to get it out. And we, the victim, we are, it's very strange, but we need the perpetrator to tell the story. We, of course, we know what is the story, because people like Van Natt, the painter in S21, he was a prisoner at S21 center. He know everything. He know what is the life at S21. But he needs somebody, the perpetrator, to confirm what happened there. You know, like when Primo Levi was liberated from the camp and he on the way back to Italy, he was afraid that when he tells the story, people will not believe it. And all the victims afraid that what they tell will not be taken by the new generation. So we need now the perpetrator to confirm, but it's absurd. Even historian, you know, we historians sometimes prefer the testimony of the perpetrator than the victim, sometimes.
Okay, sometime. I hope the projectionist is ready to show us this little clip from S21 where we see the perpetrators and the victims together. So let's roll.
วิธีทัวร์เอกสารเตรียมเรียบจำวีเอาสะเซชะจีวัดวีแต่ก็บอดแต่อ่านตะเคยดำเนินเรื่องกบกันปีรั่วให้เจ้าสดายจะบ้าจะบ้าเมียนไฮพอลเมียนมูลธานอัมพีจารกรรมซีรุงติขนงเจียระยะตามแผนการวีล้อบังพอดคือเอาวีสะเซชวนวีเมียนสำได้วีเมียนเคลียประโยชน์วีวิธีนาการสำหรับยืมเนี่ยเนี่ยต้องเปลี่ยนสู่จำไรวิมีนปีย่างจีบข้างโยบายคือยืมโฆษณาจีบวีจอบกินได้จีบบรรทอมบรรทอมกรุ๊ปเปลวเลียเพื่อตัวรุ่นกรรมยืมวิธีนาการรวมซ้ำพิศากรลำมกระวังมดยืมเนี่ยสู่จำไรคือจานแทะไปข้างตัวรุ่นกรรมเมื่อทุนตัวรุ่นกรรมยืมการโฆษณานี่จีบพิศากรโกงได้ยืมเต้าบ่มเปี้ยจอบกินได้ชาติขมังปุ่มชลายสารเพียบเอายื่นสู้สารเพียบไปยื่นทุนรูปใบก่อเวียสารเพียบขนมกำลังเกียบบังพัดจี้มันพัดไปเพื่อตัวรุนการตีก้อนแต่ข้อขี้ปรังเต็จอิจฉาปนอ
เป็นอย่างล่างวายเนี่ยโต้ยังเมื่อประตูโต้ยประตูทมฝัดดาบาดใดเลยประตูทมสามหมุนเนี่ยโต้เลยดับใบมาได้ยอดเนี่ยตู้เลยดับใบยังมวยยอดสูง
ยอดดับใบเลย
มา
ไงดับใบเงือบหอยเป็นเงือบมันโยกมาจองมุกกมาจองมุกเฮ้ยวัดได้แบบก้อยดักขนอกดักขนอกเฮ้ยโอ้จักรโซ่จักรโซ่ไปเจนตู้โชว์แบบไรสมัยโซ่ได้ดำไปบอกเกียร์ได้ตู้เจนกราว
นั่งเฮ้ยยังตัวเนี่ยตัว ពីអ្នកយាមខ្ញុំយកដៃក្រៀកប្រឡោះដៃអ្នកទោសហ្នឹងគឺបដារចេញទៅបញ្ហាធ្វើទរណកម្មសំណុំពរនៃការធ្វើទរណកម្មគឺយកចម្លើយរបស់វាប្រមាណធ្វើដើម្បីសុបាយទេដូចនេះត្រូវធ្វើឲ្យវាឈឺដើម្បីឲ្យវាឆាប់ឆ្លើយសំណុំពរម្យ៉ាងទៀតគឺកាច់វាឲ្យខ្លាចបាក់ស្បាតមិនមែនធ្វើតាមកំហឹងបុគ្គលឲ្យអស់ក្តៅដូចនេះគឺវាយឲ្យវាខ្លាចតែមិនឲ្យងាប់ដាច់ខាតពេលធ្វើទរណកម្មត្រូវពិនិត្យសុខភាពវាមុនត្រូវពិនិត្យមើលរំពាត់កុំលោភចង់ឆាប់នាំឲ្យស្លាប់បាត់ឯកសារខាតនេះជាបញ្ជីឈ្មោះខ្មាំងដែលក្រុមគៀមយកមកសួរចម្លើយនេះឈ្មោះមិត្តអ្នកសួរឈ្មោះខ្ញុំប្រាក់ខនអ្នកណានប្រធានក្រុមគៀមក្រុមសួរចម្លើយមាន3ក្រុមមានក្រុមស្លូតក្រុមក្តៅនិងក្រុមគៀមអញ្ចឹងក្រុមស្លូតគឺមានភារកិច្ចគេសួរគៀបសង្កត់ផ្នែកនយោបាយមកកាលណាសួរគៀបសង្កត់ផ្នែកនយោបាយចេញហើយគេធ្វើឯកសារដល់នឹងហើយអ្នកណាដែលសួរមិនចេញគឺគេរុញឲ្យខាងក្រុមក្តៅក្រុមក្តៅយកមកគេវាយធ្វើទរណកម្មខ្លះវាយបែកខ្នងបែកក្បាលហូរឈាមស្រាក់ខ្លះក៏សួរទៅចេញព្រោះឯកសារនៅទីនោះហើយបើសួរមិនចេញអានឹងគេរុញឲ្យមកខាងក្រុមគៀមក្រុមគៀមយកមកវាយតាមអំពាត់ពីនឹងបែកឈាមពេញខ្នងដោយថារបួសចាស់អត់តន់ជាហើយខ្លះក៏ធ្វើទៅចេញឲ្យសរសេរឯកសារទៅខ្លះមិនចេញទៅគៀមរ៉ាំរៃនឹងយូរខែយូរឆ្នាំទៅខ្លះក៏បានការខ្លះក៏មិនបានការគេយកទុកចោលទៅការធ្វើទរណកម្មកាលនោះគឺក្នុងចិត្តមានសហាវខូខៅដោយគ្មានការពិចារណាអ្វីគឺមានអំណាចអំណួតខ្លួនហ្នឹងទៅលើខ្មាំងគឺថាมันគិតពីអាយុជីវិតគេទេគេថាឃើញអាយុជីវិតអ្នកទោះដូចជាសត្វជាធាតចឹងហើយក្នុងការលើកដៃធ្វើទរណកម្មគឺគ្មានចិត្តមួយថាទប់ខួរក្បាលហ្នឹងមិនអោយដៃហ្នឹងវាយមិនអោយជើងហ្នឹងតតទេគឺថាមានទាំងចិត្តទាំងដៃទៅទាំងអស់ស្របគ្នាហ្មងការធ្វើទនកម្មហ្នឹងហើយអ្នកទោះចូលមកក្នុងមន្ទីរស-21មិនមែនមិនដឹងថាស្លាប់គឺដឹងថាមកដល់កន្លែងមន្ទីរស-21ដឹងថាយកចម្លើយអស់ហើយគឺត្រូវថាសម្លាប់ចោលទាំងអស
់ពេលហ៊ុនយាមក្នុងមួយជុំអាថ្ងៃគឺពិនិត្យសបាន4ដងពន្លត់សោចាក់ដើមលើកសងរូនមើលមើលតាមអានោមវិញខ្នោះវិញហ្នឹងរូនមើលក៏អត់អីអត់អីក៏មួយអាមួយខ្សែទៀតចាក់ដើមលើកសងរូនរូនមើលមើលតាមខ្នោះវិញហ្នឹងក៏អត់អីដើមួយកណ្ដាលដើមួយកណ្ដាលប្រឹកអូអាមួយខ្សែលើកដៃដល់លើកដៃវឹបងឹបចាក់ដើមឆែកឆែកឆេឆែកឆេវិញហ្នឹងចាប់ផ្ដើមច្បាច់ច្បោះច្បាច់ច្បោះច្បោះមើលកបោខវានឹងចេះឡងចុះមួយជាមួយមើលនេះមើលនោះមើលនោះមើលនេះដើមមើលវាខ្លាចវាមានលាបកាខ្លាចវាមានយកលាបកានឹងចាក់តសាយដៃនឹងខ្លាចសម្រាប់ខ្លួនហើយខ្លាចវាមានខ្ចៅខ្ចងនឹងក្នុងកបោខក្នុងកបោអើនឹងខ្លាចវាយកលៀបសម្រាប់ខ្លួនព្រោះដើមមកចង់កដាលអើគួយគួយស្ងៀមមួអាមួយខ្សែទៀតអើអាមួយខ្សែងើបងើបឈោអលើដៃដៃចាប់ដើមវ៉ាក់ឆែកឆែកឆេរវានឹងពិនិត្យមើលនឹងច្បាច់នេះច្បាច់នោះមើលកបោខមើលចកេះខវាបាច់ច្បល់ច្បាច់ច្បល់បាច់ច្បល់នឹងរួចចាំមើលខ្លាច់ពិនិត្យមើលទៅខ្លាច់វាមានលាបកាយកមកចាក់សរសៃដៃនឹងខ្លាច់វាស្លាប់ខ្លួនហើយខ្លួនខ្លាច់មានខ្ចៅមានខ្ចោវាលេបទៅសម្លាប់ខ្លួនដើរមកកណ្ដាលហោគួយអណាគួយស្ងៀមចាប់ផ្ដើមដើរមកហាអាយអាណាអូអាយដោះអាវអាយគ្នាការអនុញ្ញាតពីនាយកអាយហ៊ានដោះអាវហ៊ានដោះអាវអាយយកអាវចោះគាត់មកអាវចាប់ផ្ដើមអាវទាញអាយយកមកក្រៅមក
So this is always shocking to look at because you don't know if it's regression or brainwash Did these people, when they finally lived through these acts again, reflect on what happened? Did they understand what happened to themselves?
I think that probably they understand, but maybe not at the same way than me. But if they start to talk to me, I think that they want also to be, to exchange with me, to take something out from his heart. And but this one is not the most cruel God. And he was at my age at the time. And that's why I talked to him, because he was 13 and he was at perpetrator side, and I was at victim side. And I need to meet him to try to understand how they can become like God like this, you know. And when I start to talk with him, he cannot talk to me. He want to talk to me, but he cannot talk. And sometimes he just few words came out from his mouth. And he tried to explain me by complete his word by the gesture. And that gave me idea that maybe you can speaking and moving at the same time. I can see that there's some memory come from his gesture, his body, and each time at the end of the sequence, he have a fever. You know, we give him some medicine because he like the air will come out of his body. You know, it's very strange. But it's very, very difficult to film the death or to film the sequence like that, because this guy can be quickly very fascinated by the evil, and you can lost the sacred, you know, of the death. For example, in this take, if you move with the guy, if you come too close to him, you can walk on the victim on the floor. I cannot watch this sequence without seeing the victim on the floor. And that's why I decide not to go with him. Of course, we walk together every day, but I keep my place. And it's hard for me already to go inside this room and to capture the chronology of the gesture. This one thing, and that's why it's, the death is sacred. If you, the image of the death, you don't respect that, you become voyeur. Or you can change the side, you can go to other side with the perpetrator. And at each moment, the evil, it's very fascinated for images. They are good for images. So you have to stay very calm. And the chronology is very interesting, because I would like to demonstrate that there is an indoctrination to this guy at 30 years. So I at 13 years, I need to understand how the ideology transformed the gesture. And this is an educated gesture. It's an ideology gesture. There's a chronology, you know. You cannot liberate, take off the bar before handcuff first, or you have to put the blindfold first, and handcuffed before to take off the bar. And you come 100 times, it's the same chronology, because he was learned to do that. It's never changed. At night, I try at night, at noon, at afternoon, every time. It's the same chronology.
It's like a machine.
Yeah,
it's automated.
Yeah, it's a proof that, it's a proof for me. I think that at 13 or 12, if people take their children and give the power of life to their children, every children can become a perpetrator.
I don't know if there are people in the audience who have seen the film or other of Rithy Panh's films or would like to ask some questions related to what we've been just discussing. There are two microphones in the audience. So please wait for the microphone if you have a question. Raise your hand so the people will be able to see. For us on the stage, it's hard to see, but I see there's already a question over there.
Thank you. First of all, I want to thank you for all the knowledge that you're sharing with us. I'm from Colombia, so your work is very enlightening for me because you know that we have a conflict for the last 60 years. I saw S21 maybe 2 weeks ago, but this year I saw also the act of killing, and I want to know what is your perception of the reenactment made in that film comparing to your film. What do you think about Dennis Oppenheim technique, and what do you think about how to face a perpetrator, the difference that exists between that film and your film?
It's George is a friend, so it's very difficult to talk about a friend work. it's really hard. So I know George many years ago, and I think that S21 inspired him a little bit at the beginning, and he take the idea, and he remarkably he pushed it for very far. It's a good film for discussion because I like very much the film, but sometimes I feel some trouble in my head. For me, I don't like to let my place to perpetrator. Because the only possibility for me to fight back is to keep my place behind the camera. I don't want to let this for them. But I understand George, and he do it because he want them to really go as far as he can. And George has not the same past like me, you know. I am a survivor. I don't like this situation, and I need to fight back. I need to. I don't let my place. I cannot let my place. How to direct my film? It's only my possibility for you to hear my point, or to hear my voice, or to see my point of view. And this is the point that in the act of killing that disturbed me.
Any other questions?
Hello, and my question is, what's your personal opinion? Is it important to keep time distance between when you make movie about this war conflict or political conflict? Or Could you make some movie about something what's going on now? Is it important for you, like a director, to take rest and time and look back?
Il s'agit donc de. Il est important pour vous qu'il y ait une distance dans le temps entre le film que vous faites et l'événement réel.
Yes, for me, yes. Because we don't make the same work than journalist. You have two time. One time, journalist have to inform to. It's what happened somewhere, the crime to inform. And maybe cineast, film director, come maybe have to come a little bit with more, with the possibility to dig really the subject, you know. And I'm talking about the film like S21. And in fact, you cannot film S21 in the real time. Only the Khmer Rouge can film S21, who can take photo picture of S21. No, us victim cannot have camera, you cannot,
but
you know.
But you made films in contemporary Cambodia, such as Paper,
yeah,
Cannot some, Grab
some,
Embers.
Sometimes, you know, for social issue, for example, I can go immediately. It's a panel subject, but for the Land of Wandering Soul, we are talking about what we are talking about globalization. It's 1997. We follow our work of people who lying the cable, optic cable for internet, and it start from Frankfurt. It will go to Shanghai, and. And people in Cambodia have just to dig it and put it on the trench, small trench like that, and the optic cable run like that across a country. And these people earn less than $1 a day. And it's very hard, and it's about the globalization, how the bank, how the bank found this project, for example. You know, you can go immediately to film the subject today. You know, today. But for certain film like Missing Picture, I cannot do it before. It's not because I talk directly about my history. It's because I did not find the form. I did not find the. As I say before, I need to give a proposal, you know, a cinematography form, because if I don't bring it, I'm just give a testimony. You know, I don't want to do that.
I think there was another question in the front here.
I know your work for quite a long time. I think most of the films I know, and just a question about the memory. I saw other films about Cambodia where the people were not so very happy to remember. And I just wonder how the reaction in Cambodia is to your work, how far the people like you to get to that old things. On the other hand, I'm also interested in your own process in just digesting these things, remembering these things, how far you got from doing that work.
Oh, yes. When I start to work on memory in Cambodia, a lot of people tell me to stop. Sometimes they send me letter that very crazy letter to ask me to stop because added shame for our country, etc. Especially when I talk about also the prostitute. And some of them, when I screen a film in France, for example, where a lot of Cambodian in Paris, there's no Cambodian in the theater, sometimes one Cambodian. And it's normal. It's normal situation because when you come out from a genocide, you don't like to talk about what you are living, you know, like animals, or you have to eat roots to survive. And you fight to survive, and you want to watch at the future, and you want to send your children to school. And the problem will happen to these people when they are when they start to feel in good condition, economic and social condition, and that's the ghost come back into haunt again. And now a lot of people watch the film, especially the young people. And I receive some mail, some in my Facebook page. A lot of young people write to me because they want to know why their grandparents are dead, for example. Are they committed some crime or what happened? And for people of my generation now, also they start to speak a little bit. You know, it's that why some subject we need time and we cannot go faster. And because it's serious. I'm not sure because we are not sure by we feel better after talking the story. And the psy told me that you must to talk, you feel better, but I don't feel better. It's not true. It depends, you know. It's talking, and you can feel free. Of course, you can talk, but I'm not sure.
It's like at the end of The Missing Picture. You're now giving the image to us. I think there's time for one final question, and then I think it's really up to us, the audience, to start thinking about the pictures, and also you can see the film after this one. So is there one final question? I think there's one hand over there, or?
Hi, well, first of all, thank you for being here. I really enjoyed your lecture. And comparing S21 and The Missing Picture, it kind of came to me that you're exploring topics that none of us probably actually came to visit or lived through. And you're touching upon the subject how we might never understand because we don't have the images to show us what actually happened. And upon that, it seems that you're trying to recreate the image, not substitute the existing one, but find the details, the evidence of what the image should have looked like and recreate it. And I was wondering, why do you think that only by seeing, only through visual language, we can actually understand what happened? Is everything else not enough? Do we have to see it in order to understand? Thank you.
Well, I don't know. Maybe people are lazy to read. You know, when Primo Levi write his first book, there's only 600 book sell. Only 600. It's not enough. No, I think that in Cambodia also, you know, one day we have a center in Phnom Penh. It's called Bopana Center, and we invite the village chief to come and to set up a program for their village,
yeah
their own village. And I see the chief take a lot of film archive. Why you take Khmer Rouge again? Take some fiction film for your people. They need to lost, they need to dream, they need to, you know, the life is difficult. Why you take again Pol Pot? It is because when my people have heard about Pol Pot but never see Pol Pot. And until they never seen Pol Pot, they cannot believe that Pol Pot exists. That's why we need images. That, you know, we probably to one of the big, the strong, guess reason it's make me to make the to work on a film archive to create this center. Tomorrow, you know, every people can have a smartphone, and even when they earn less than $1 a day, but they will have a smartphone, and this smartphone push them to eat global, think global. Everything is global, except their history and their culture and their identity. That why the film, the film archive, film need to be put inside the cable or the optic cable, you know,
and
that
internet.
We like it before. If we don't do that, of course, if they don't see Pol Pot, they cannot believe that Pol Pot exists. Just heard, heard it's not exist. Just read it not exist. That because we live in images, we live in an era of image. Everything is image and sound. And if you cannot see on your smartphone, the democracy, but you cannot believe in democracy. If you cannot see the fight for freedom in smartphone, but you cannot believe that there is a fight for freedom.
Rithy Panh, thank you so much for giving us some images.
Thank you. Merci.
Yeah.
Merci. Oh, les fleurs.
Merci. Merci.
Merci. Merci. Merci.